Just want to get your thoughts on the announcement from the government yesterday. It was already forecast a couple of years ago, but the $750 million spend on defence upgrades in the north, what did you make of them?
Well, I think that's wonderful. And like you said, it had already been announced a few years ago. So I would like to see that put into action, not just the announcements, not just talk the talk, but if they can walk the walk. There's a lot of uncertainty around the world right now, especially with China and what is going on. I think what they need to do, though, is they really need to go back to the grassroots of what is going on. We're having big problems in our military. We're having massive amounts of discharges going through at the moment with those men and women who have been in the Middle East, and all those expertise is going out the door, especially at those lower ranks, and that is very worrying for me. The other thing is people just do not seem to be willing joining our military. And when you look at the numbers of full-time military that we have, it is just over enough to fill the MCG. So don't come out and make announcements. You're telling us you're going to put missiles out there. Get them out there at the top end. Make sure we're absolutely covered, because if anything, even if we're not ready yet, at least use something as a deterrent. We are an island nation, and I would suggest they get that, get their heads around that, mate, and start doing a little bit more than what they're doing, because they are way too slow and they are years behind for protecting our country.
Why do you think that would have been, Senator? Why do you think our preparedness is not where it should be?
I just think that they used, you know, that many of those troops that were in the Middle East were rotated, went through many different rotations. That's the first issue we had. They went through multiple rotations. Those people are suffering physical and psychological injuries. They are discharging medically and so forth. Those expertise will have a massive gap, and if they haven't picked that up, they should have done. They need to open their eyes. We need a lot more boots on the ground, mate. And quite frankly, I don't give a stuff we start talking about National Service or a National Guard. But we need to do something. It will not help those young people to grow their resilience, that generation coming through that are under 20, and start putting them through 12 months worth of military service. It certainly won't hurt them, and it won't hurt the country. And like I said, we are an island nation. You know, we're extremely vulnerable. And when you don't have missiles at the top there already, and you don't have a great deal of them as a deterrent, then I think we are just way behind the mark here.
Yeah, well, I mean, I spoke to a professor yesterday on security, and he mentioned that preparedness is nowhere near what it should be, and highlighted the fact that our fuel supplies are so low. So if we ever get dragged into a conflict, well, there's a big mark against us right there.
Oh, I'm glad you mentioned that. I actually did the fuel security inquiry, I think, in 2015, and it blew me off my seat. You know, have fuel for planes, for example, there's about 48 hours. You know, there's about 9 or 10 days worth of your normal diesel, unleaded, et cetera, et cetera. We've got two refineries pretty much left in this country. Mm. You know, so I think there's many other areas that they should be looking at here. And that is, you know, that in itself is extremely scary, what I heard coming out of that inquiry when it comes to our fuel security in this country.
Yeah, and I'll ask you about Mike Pezzullo's comments in just a moment, but off the back of those, the commentary from China in response to Pezzullo's comments was that, well, they're not fussed about us militarily because we're not a strong country. That's what China said. We don't have a strong military force. It's basically what they were saying. So in that sense, have they got a point if we are so unprepared?
I think that, you know, anybody in their right mind would know how unprepared we are, and look, certainly those men and women who wear our uniform and give that sacrifice, we are very grateful for them. But I tell you what, you might want to start lifting those numbers very, very quickly with the way the rest of the world is going with instability. I don't believe the Secretary has a minister. It is not for the Secretary to come out and do that. Last time I checked, they are not a minister. It is not for him to do that. I've had a gutful of these secretaries of departments actually running those departments, and the minister's not doing their job. They are paid more than enough. Now show some spine, stop throwing things on your secretaries, and you come out and you speak about your portfolio yourself. Show some courage.
Is he wrong? I mean, he says it was just a lament that the drums of war are beating. What do you make of what he said specifically?
Well, quite frankly, like I said, I don't believe that he should never have given that interview to start with. He's getting way too big for his own boots and he needs to be pulled back behind the line, that's for sure. But you know what, I imagine that China is probably thinking the same thing that I am. The minister doesn't have the courage to come out and say something and he's throwing his lapdog out there. It's quite embarrassing, to be honest with you.
Well, I mean, it was a letter that he had written on Anzac Day to his staff that ended up being leaked, as these things do, from time to time. But still, the words were said that the drums of war are beating. Do you feel, though, that something's going on here with China and perhaps a flashpoint emerging in Taiwan, that the US may well be dragged in, and if that happens, then Australia would be dragged in? I mean, are we putting the cart before the horse here? Do you see this happening, or is it just a bit of inflammatory talk?
Oh, it is definitely reality. And I'll tell you what, if you are going to throw that sort of stuff out there, you had better make sure that you are prepared, you know, to take action. Mm. But if you are not prepared, I suggest you go back to the preparation first before you start throwing things like that out there. The other thing is, if you were going to release a letter like that in your department, you know exactly what I do. That is going to be released out. That is why you do that in the first place.
Yeah.
So, that is exactly what he was trying to do, and it got out and it got leaked because that's exactly what he wanted it to do.
Okay. Just on to India, new records have been set again today, Senator. Was it the right call in stopping the flights and helping in the ways that we are by sending the equipment and trying to help fix the problem there?
We certainly need to do what we can to help India, and if we have excess equipment while we are not using it, as long as if something hits there, we've got our own backup ready to go. I don't have a problem in helping other countries with what is going on with COVID-19. I can tell you now, though, when it comes to marriages and deaths, I do not find it appropriate that a minority are getting their own way and saying because of that they want to go over. Here we were, we went through COVID-19 and on our own home soil, mate, people could not attend funerals because they were done in low numbers. Mm. You know, so it's like a real slap across the face. It's enough of that. I want to see those Australians come home. I don't know why they haven't already, a lot more haven't been sent home, but to allow people to go over to India right now in the state it is in with marriages and deaths, I think is absolutely mind-boggling.
Just finally, you got a tip for the election this weekend?
Oh, geez, mate, I tell you, she may be a hung parliament. Could be very interesting Tasmania in the next few years.
All right. Senator Jackie Lambie, appreciate your time as always. Good to chat. Talk to you soon.
Thanks very much.